Now, during our Prime Minister's questions today, the Prime Minister was asked by the Labour leader, Sir Keir Starmer, to step up the government's response to racial inequality.
So can the Prime Minister now turbocharge the government's responses and tell us when he'll implement in full the Lammy report and the Windrush recommendations?
We are trying to ensure, amongst other things, that young BME people are not immediately prosecuted as a result of the trouble they find themselves in, and we try to make sure that we give people a chance. But I must stress that on the Lammy report and on all these matters, it is absolutely vital at the same time that we keep our streets safe and that we back our police. And that is what we are going to do.
Boris Johnson there. We can speak now to Lord Woolley, director and founder of the Operation Black Vote, which aims to promote greater racial justice and equality in the UK. Thank you for being with us. And earlier we heard George Floyd's brother speaking to Congress and saying, I don't want him to be just another face on another T-shirt. Do you fear that that is the way it may turn out?
Well, there's been a lot of awfulness. First of all, the disproportionality of black and brown people dying with COVID-19. And then the lynching, the daylight lynching of George Floyd. I mean, it's been some truly awfulness. But within that, I'm feeling this could also be a fantastic moment, because it seems that the society has been convulsed to lay bare some uncomfortable truths, some historical uncomfortable truths, and also some ones that we are living with right now. The question is, how will we respond? But we will be brave enough to have a look at those historical legacies that actually have made us to what we are today in regards to the deep-seated inequality in employment, in education, in housing, many of which have been contributory elements to the rise in those deaths we've seen in COVID. And then the historical analysis, within the statues and the history behind it. Are we bold enough and brave enough to say, look, this is a country that was built on oppression, and the institutions that benefited from it are still there today? The Bank of England, Lloyd's of London, RSB, the universities, the two big universities, enriched themselves from slavery and colonialism and maintained the status quo in which the elite still benefit today.
Yeah, and it's about politics, clearly, and leadership, clearly, to a considerable degree. This happened in America. Do you think Donald Trump has the empathy for the plight of many black people and communities in the United States?
In a word, no. I think we need change there. I hope Boris Johnson does. I mean, we've heard the rhetoric. We heard, listened to his statement, and he said he recognises institutional racism. Now, the next step is to find solutions. Because the thing is this, all those people on the streets, they want action. You heard the rapper Tinchy Snyder saying we want action. We've said we need a COVID-19 race equality strategy that looks at education, health, housing, employment, and says we need a plan from A to B to Z. And when we implement that plan, actually, we begin to unlock talent so everybody benefits. This is a truly historical moment in which I think historians will look back and say, how did we respond? I just hope that we take the bull from the horns and look at all those areas. Instead of putting a plaster, Band-Aid, over a gaping wound, we implement major surgery, a root and branch change, because when we do, we better understand our history, who we are, why we look at people in different ways. But economically, we begin to unleash talent. And right now, we absolutely need that as we come into a cycle, an economic downturn, I think, in your last report, the likes of which we haven't seen for generations. We need to be battle ready for that. And that needs some honest conversation, honest reflection, and a grand plan. A grand plan that essentially is a new social and race equality contract.
Yeah, I mean, in a grand plan, you know, while we're still dealing with coronavirus, and you talk about Boris Johnson, Bonnie Greer says that he should first apologise for his racist comments before he will be taken seriously over Black Lives Matter. She was talking about those newspaper articles about women in burqas looking like bank robbers and so forth. I mean, do you agree? Does he have to first apologise for those comments to be taken seriously?
Look, I want Boris Johnson to say, I recognise your pain. I am the leader of this country and I will sit round the table with you with a grand plan. More urgent than ever, because for too long, for people, for no other reason than the colour of their skin, people have been locked out. You know, we talked about criminal justice. 40% of youth incarceration is black and minority ethnic. I mean, often the police racially profile these young men and women in such disproportionate numbers that it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. We've got to give these young kids hope, not see them as criminals, give them a pathway to success. When we do that, everybody benefits. And it's not just the same for black and brown kids. Working class kids too get truly stigmatized. Everybody's got to be brought into the arena in which they can fulfill their great potential. But it needs leadership. Leadership at the top, number 10 Downing Street, our universities, our schools, our businesses. And when I come on to businesses, I would say the lowest hanging fruit would be to have ethnic minority pay gap reporting, in which will transform your businesses and recognise the skill right on your doorstep.
And you talked a little earlier about COVID and the impact that has had on, or disproportionately on, ethnic minorities. There was a Public Health England report that sort of stated what the issue is, but didn't come up with recommendations. What did you make of that?
Yeah, I thought it lacked recommendations. You know, this disease does not target people because of their race. What this disease has done is laid bare deep-seated inequalities, those on zero-hour contracts, low pay, who had little or no choice but to put their lives and their families' lives in danger to pay the rent. You follow the disease and you will see those areas in which within our society that need major surgery, inequality in health, housing, jobs, the criminal justice system. You know, this is a moment for us to stand up. We've got to get this right. I tell you what I'm worried about. Right now, people are saying Black Lives Matter. We need to do something. I'm a little bit afraid that in a month's time, people will be weary of this conversation and say, well, we've done that now. Can we go back? We mustn't go down there. We need a new norm that sees potential, that offers creativity for all communities, yeah, and gives those people on the street that are tearing down these statues, above all, gives them hope.
But just finally, I mean, you know what it's like. You know, the world moves on from these events and news cycles move on. And do you fear that the tension will be diverted away?
Well, there's a window. There's the most fantastic window that I've seen in my lifetime for us to do great things. I spoke when we began this conversation that we've seen some real awfulness. You know, the knee that killed George Floyd wasn't just the knee of the individual. It was the knee of the American system. The disproportionate deaths we've seen in COVID is not just the disease, it's the infrastructure that put people more at danger. We have a once-in-a-lifetime, I would argue, a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to put them things right, not just for today and tomorrow, but for a generation. That means all of us must play a part. And if we do that, then we'll all benefit from it.
And, I mean, do you think there is... still an issue, a serious issue with the criminal justice system in this country? The statistics suggest there is, clearly.
I sat with David Lammy on that review that was put together actually by David Cameron. And, you know, you had a black woman and a white woman, both charged with drug dealing, and one got three times a sentence than the other. It's heartbreaking. And the way sometimes the police view young black men as criminals, and then the interaction can easily explode into violence. We've got to change all of that. I'm working with the police force. I'm one of the directors of Police Now, a new platform to nurture a generation of police, black and white, that will police with consent, that will have a better understanding of how to police a multiracial society. Honestly, we can do this. I'm angry, but also positive. And I want to bring all those dynamics together and say, let's seize this opportunity that will make us a truly Great Britain, not a Great Britain of the colonial past. I want none of that. I want a Great Britain that recognises we are a multiracial society. There's teeming dynamism right across the country, in every street, etc. And let's use this awfulness to make that happen.
OK, Lord Woolley, thank you very much indeed.